Their electricity is dangerous. It is. I can't attempt to do the Essex accent involved. But it was always something my mother remembered very vividly, and particularly when she read, my mother, when she was an undergraduate, Flowers in the Grass by Monica Dickens. I've not read it in detail myself, but she pointed out to me it's a book that starts with the death of the main female figure, a so-called housewife, when she plugs in a kettle to make tea. And that in the 1940s was not such a surprising thing to happen, or at least the fear of it was not so. And I have to say that listening to my mother, and I think this is always a good thing for any historian to do, made me think there is something in this. I want to know more about this. And it stayed at the back of my mind for some time. So when I became an historian of science, I looked into the history of electrification, thinking where I might go after my PhD. And I found, frustratingly, nothing to speak to what my mother had told me about these issues. Everyone, I assume, in this meeting is familiar with the work of Thomas Hughes' Networks of Power, Electrification in Western Society, sometimes called How the West Was Wired. I know it's obviously a classic in terms of laying out the hegemony of system builders, and particularly network engineers and entrepreneurs such as Edison, who managed to get the world made somewhat, more electrical. But it's fascinating looking back at it now. The passivity of consumers is assumed. I think very obvious to users and engineer that everyone in the end did take up electricity, so there's no doubt it would actually happen. And women are barely mentioned. There's only I think Hertha Ayrton as the spouse of William Ayrton mentioned in the book at all. Moving then on 3 years later to Disenchanted Knight, a rather different book that's much more cultural history, but a somewhat determinist thesis about the inevitability, I think, if I'm not caricaturing too much, about how households would modernize by adapting to electric light, replacing gas, changing all the aesthetics too. And once again, we see the acquiescence of consumers presumed, although some discomfort at the changing aesthetics involved. And we'll hear more about this in Abigail's paper, I'm sure, later. But we do at least see in Shiva Bush's book the role of women as household advisors and how to redecorate in relation to the new kind of aesthetics that one gets from the different kind of light obtained from electricity. But there isn't much beyond that in terms of the agency or the resistance of women, and I'm still thinking, where do we go to find more on that? So two further books I looked into, Ruth Schwartz-Cowan's wonderful book, More Work for Mother, The Ironies of Household Technology from the Open Hearth to the Microwave, a prize-winning book, a really powerful and sometimes extremely sad volume about how the way women founded the revolution in the home that was supposed to liberate them actually ended up giving them the worst possible deal, technologies that didn't save them time at all, actually made them much more reliant upon the expertise of others, having to be their own individual servants. Here again, we see the acquiescence of women assumed by Schwartz-Cowan, but at least a contrast to the work of Hughes that doesn't mention women at all. Carolyn Marvin, a few years after that, takes slightly different view. She at least brings in women's views much, much more often. But she tends to cast electrical expertise as primarily masculine. The only real experts that she talks about, in contrast to Shiva Bush, are men. And women, although they can do things like model the Statue of Liberty, as you see there being done by Mrs. Vanderbilt, have no other role other than deferring to experts to have their anxiety supposedly allayed. Again, this is not satisfying. I thought, where is the expertise and agency of women? Is it totally irrelevant in these accounts? There must be more to be said about this. So the answer came in this project, Science in the 19th Century Periodical, a very big team project that was led by Sally Shuttleworth, now at Oxford, and Geoffrey Cantor, then at Leeds. And it brought to my attention various things, not least of which the value of team working. It may be that some people find solitary working, as in the PhD, most valuable, but in this work, it was extremely helpful to have other people leading on discussions about how to interpret the source, such as the general journal. This was, for example, not science journals, but things like the 19th Century, the Quarterly Review, the Fortnightly Review, general public culture. And we all looked to find what kinds of science there might be, and it was astonishing how much there was in public culture in the 19th Century General Journal. And actually, I found a great deal of coverage of electricity, which was really quite startling. Something that was perhaps touched upon to some extent by Carolyn Marvin, but nothing like, well, explaining why you have, for example, genteel aristocrats writing about electricity. It's really quite remarkable. They were so informed about what they were talking about and also had clearly entrepreneurial interests involved. Not the kind of thing one heard about in the 1980s, when it was supposed the British aristocrats were the most backward and anti-technological of all the elements of British society. But what were they doing? Why were they there? And also important was the sight of Mrs. Alice Gordon. She called herself Alice Gordon, Mrs. Gordon, differently in different volumes, writing about decorative electricity. Again, not mentioned by Wolfgang Schieferbusch, but clearly extremely well informed about the technological issues of electricity, and wanting to write for both male and female readers in the 19th century about how exactly, the Fortnightly Review, how to make electricity something that was amenable and comfortable in a world of luxury in the 1890s. So what was happening? Fortunately, thanks to my friend Sophie Forgan, with whom I've been in discussion many years, this book came to my attention, which is the volume of Decorative Electricity, with a lovely, elegant front cover. And you can see there, she writes under her married name as the spouse of electrical engineer J.E.H. Gordon, and it became a theme of domestic electricity, how many women were involved collaboratively as spouses of engineers. Clearly, the idea one sees in Thomas Hughes that engineers worked on their own can't always be true. And if you look at the history of much industry and business, you see women are often there as part of a family team working in engineering. And this was just one example of that to be brought out and explored further. Sorry, I should give you a bit of trigger warning here. There's some figures of women which came to the fore, one of which was the advert for Faraday and Sons Artistic Fittings, which appears in Mrs. Gordon's book, a floating goddess holding a light up. And it was pointed out to me by an art historian, I think it might even have been Abigail, how this comes from a tradition of classical imagery, women holding up the truth, the light of the truth, even the naked truth, floating magically. And you see this reproduced several decades later in an advert for the Mazda electric lamp by Thompson Houston. There was something happening here, and when I went to the Bakken Museum in Minneapolis in 2006, I found many, many more examples of this across a lot of electrical literature too. There was something to be explained here. This wasn't innocent art just being pretty. There was something going on, and this helped me formulate the notion of domesticating electricity. With the help of my colleague Greg Raddick, who actually was the one that proposed the book's title to me, which of course nicely converged with the work of domestication theory, that of Roger Silberstone and his colleagues, looking at the cultures of household technology, trying to get over the deterministic notion of modernization as somehow a process that was inevitable and without discretion. This domestication theory, put very simply, is the thesis that technologies have to be assimilated and tamed into domestic order. They don't naturally fit. They have to have a complex symbiosis with their users, actually, and an ongoing attempt to tame, which is never perhaps entirely complete. Now, those of you who read the book, and I'm not suggesting that any of you have to read it, will recognize these themes: electricity as danger, safety, and the future, and as aesthetics and personification. I won't need to say to you too much about it now, but I guess one of the key things was in formulating the volume, I wanted to make sure that uncertainty and gender were up front, because I wanted to indicate how much was unknown about electricity, how much consumers and even experts didn't seem to know. And that gender mattered also, in that there were clearly complicated ways in which women's roles and men's roles were partly mutually defining, but partly somewhat in conflict in deciding how electricity was going to be domesticated, actually, on whose terms. Why only up to 1914 was the next question, I suppose. Well, I think in those days seen that 1914, the start of World War I, was an actual breakage point. Things will be different after that. But it was always clear to me that there would be much more to be said. I mean, could one possibly say that the domestication of electricity was complete by 1914? Well, almost certainly not. And I'm very pleased that, for example, Paul Coleman's PhD thesis had taken it on to the First World War after to reveal very different things about the growth of external grids. And more from Paul on that later on. But for example, let me give you this as something to ponder. Domestication as process or outcome. I think some people have tended to see domestication as an outcome, that actually a final process in which there was a taming of electricity which was irreversible. But I like to think much more of it as being a process that's never quite complete. And I think that indeed is the force of the Silverstone thesis. Now you might see here, for example, a picture here of Sir Joseph and Lady Hannah Swan in their home at Wallingham. Joseph Swan being, of course, one of the inventors of the electric light bulb, it turns out slightly preceding Edison, although the patents say otherwise. A long story there. Happily at home under the lights, I think possibly Joseph Swan enjoying a slightly more glaring light than his wife, but it would look as though this was a set scene where all is calm. But there's much more to be said, much more to be said. I think part of the point is that domestication doesn't say all that needs to be said. This is very clear to me now. Does it explain all that needs to be explained about how electricity came into the home, or indeed in many respects actually was resisted, and I'll talk about gas later on, or only partially adopted for certain purposes, such as, for example, only for lighting, not for cooking? And I think talking to various colleagues who have been extremely helpful in the last decade or so, it's clear to me that I think perhaps talking mostly to Karen Sarah and Abigail Harrison Moore, that material culture really is a big thing here. Whatever happens to the domestication of electricity, however successful it is, there's always the resilient presence of the hardware, whether it works or not, actually, to be thought about, and how it fits into the bigger household economy. Working with Paul Coleman, there's a very strong sense in which the bigger infrastructure outside the home must matter. It's not as if when one is consuming electricity, actually, in the present age, even from the 1920s, you could see it as separate from the rest of the world. You are tapping into a big utility, a whole landscape out there, actually, which could not help but influence what went on inside the home. So not simply the matter then of domesticating electricity in one household at a time. And talking to Anna Meschalogy, particularly valuable was the notion of colonization, both at the national level of imperialism, but also in the level of the home. The idea that in some sense, the adoption of electricity in Indian homes was a kind of colonialization, exploitative appropriation of cultural spaces. And somehow that struck me as being a very valuable metaphor that could be taken further still, but if one particularly thinks of the predatory behavior of electrical supply companies. And when one asks the question, which of these is most useful for transnational histories? Because certainly I don't want to write just about Britain anymore. I'm sure nobody here really wants to do single histories, single nation histories forever. And I kind of think maybe the notion of colonization could be perhaps one of the most useful to consider. But I look forward to hearing your views on that in the questions. Now, in all of this, what was very evident is that, you know, for decades after 1914, there was much to be said about the nature of electricity. For example, electron theory had arrived. It was very difficult for many individuals to understand it. Charles Gibson wrote a wonderful volume called The Autobiography of an Electron in 1908, which really puzzled reviewers because nobody quite knew what an electron was. It didn't actually help to explain what electricity was. So he rewrote that actually as a book called What is Electricity? And even though his full-time job was manufacturing curtains in Scotland, he wrote many books trying to help the wider public understand what was going on. And this actually is part, you know, as I said, of a bigger phenomenon. Using anthropomorphization, compliant humanized forms that mitigate the weird mystery and the immaterial nature of electricity. It still strikes me now how difficult it was for people to understand what they were paying for. There was nothing physical that was gained in the house, and even with alternating current, as much came in as went out. But you know, just to recap briefly, I mean, we know now there are, from various sources, not least Julie Bosk's excellent work, the female forms of electricity being personified. There is the fairy, la fée électricité in French, the goddess form, magically, as you saw in the advert from Mrs. Gordon. The nurturing mother figure, this one comes up in quite a few Catholic countries. And then also electricity as the servant, one sees that perhaps in the US. But there are male forms as well, which are somewhat different. And I'm intrigued to know what you think of these, whether there are more to be added. There is often the notion of Aladdin, the genie in the lamp, a male exoticized figure othered through being cast as something from outside the UK, but still under British control. There's Puck, of course, from Shakespeare, who runs around at high speed, being a little mischievous, but otherwise enlightening. There's electricity as wizard, a magical creature in charge, enabling to do things which are otherwise unimaginable with ordinary science. And then there's, of course, the demand servant. Now, I don't know how much one can explore these, because it does seem that there's little evidence about how much these images changed people's perceptions or behaviours towards electricity. I do wonder if the psychological tricks of advertising were at the heart of this, actually affecting the unconscious. So individuals did not know how they were being affected by looking at these images, and actually thereby had nothing to report, nothing to say. So I've not seen any discussions on the relative relative efficacy of different kinds of anthropomorphic representation in the adoption of electricity in the home. And I'd be interested to know if any of you have seen that. But let me just give you then, and this is, it might be a bit of a shock after this. So you see here, Electricity as a Wizard by Charles Gibson. One volume I had no idea what to do with when I wrote Domesticating was actually this volume by Charles Gibson, written 1916. And it's pretty unpleasant thing to read now. Our Good Slave Electricity, written for the children's market. Okay, and this, of course, if any of you have looked into slavery histories, I hope many of you have, this does trade on the very disingenuous myth of the good slave somehow still being loyal and contented despite being enslaved. And what this book does in rather grim ways is cover things like what our slave does, i.e. what electricity does, as if it were our slave, as if it were somehow already tamed and ordered. What is particularly shocking when one looks at the reviews, as even one in Nature, and there's no criticism at all of the invocation of this idea of slavery. It is very evident that at the height of World War One, when this book was published, nobody seemed to be too troubled about the exploitation of the good slave motif to characterize electricity. But whatever one says about the morals of that, it's also very strange to see the same author writing about electricity as a wizard, who was actually in charge, not a slave at all. And talking to a colleague, Jim Mussel, in the School of English recently, he said there's much to be said about the ways in which the same author can reuse entirely incompatible, conflicting metaphors in a series of works on the same topic. Your views on that are very welcome. But anyway, one can certainly say, and I'm very grateful to colleagues who've discussed this with me in the past, that we can't look to these anthropomorphized agencies in any way to explain the rise of electrification. While they might epitomize electricity and explain in some cultural abstract sense what is being domesticated, the physical, financial and aesthetic work has to be done by people. And there's no good just appealing to modernization. It's one of the perhaps the lazier features of some writing on electricity that says, well, modernization happened and electricity was part of that. So many people have shown that. I mean, I particularly like the work of Saoirse O'Brien in Ireland, showing how there was a very different Irish approach to the world of electrification after independence. And certainly, I want to be a little bit skeptical about the power of popularizing books and anthropomorphizations. Well, sometimes I've been tempted to think that they might have been part of what persuaded people to adopt electricity. I sometimes think, well, maybe they weren't. Perhaps they were just secondary phenomena. Maybe they were just parasitic on the back of what was going on already, and people sold these as part of the bigger package. So, I mean, again, talking to Abigail Harrison more about this and one of our projects in planning, the idea seems to be, look, really now, who were the human advocates of energy transformation? Who actually did the work of domestication? Because as it sounds itself, domestication can sound a very passive phrase, you know, domestication occurred. Well, who achieved it? Okay, that's what I would always ask. And in domesticating electricity, there are two sorts of groups that were very mostly obviously involved in ways that weren't addressed by previous books. Aristocratic technophiles, such as Lord Salisbury, despite being the most conservative politician possibly of the 19th century. And also women as authorities on electricity, whether as spouses or as independent agencies. And there's much more to be said about these roles. So let me say a bit about them now. Now, Mrs. Gordon's Decorative Electricity, there's several very interesting adverts which show you how prominent aristocrats are. If you've ever read Martin Wiener's book, English Culture and the Decline of the Industrial Spirit, you will not see these names mentioned as being involved in modernizing technologies. But you can see here for the company B. Verity & Sons, top customers listed are the Duke of Fife, Earl of Rosebery, Lord Randolph Churchill, Baron de Rothschild. And the key thing that Abigail and I have been working on is the way that these individuals have the capital to invest in risky new schemes and the leisure to experiment with them. These, after all, are the same people that try out using motor cars and aeroplanes. The fact that quite a few of this group died out in World War One, actually, that flying aeroplanes actually has led to them being a little bit invisible. But that being said, it's very important to bring out the gender issues here. The way the advertising here works is to show the male protagonist in the aristocratic household. But actually, what is evident is that the women were very much more active. Lady Churchill, for example, Jenny Germain, from the USA, was clearly the biggest advocate in the home. She was the one who negotiated with the Crompton Company to get a free installation. And rather archly, Crompton, in his autobiography, describes Lady Churchill as being a very good advertising agent for them. So a two-way process of exploitation, a kind of symbiosis. And it's that symbiosis we want to explore more. Let me give you another advertisement from the same book. Woodhouse and Rawson Limited, which points out the Marquis of Salisbury, the Marquis of Ripon, the Maharaja of Mysore are clients for that particular group. You know, aristocrats here as being glamorous and enthusiastic advocates of technological innovation. And this matters a great deal for the marketing to the rest of the world. It seems that aristocrats, very, very loosely argued, could be seen in this period actually as these celebrities, the change agents, followed by the upwardly mobile, ambitious middle-class consumers. So if the upper classes took up electricity into their homes, many others would wish to follow. Finally, this is a company that we've been looking at. It seems that much of the history of electricity has missed out the way that certain contractors made their reputations, made their capital, got their expertise for the wider project of the national grid from working with these country houses. And thanks again to Abigail for pointing me to Drake and Gorham with a separate advert from a book by Percy Scruton, Electricity in Town and Country Houses. You see here, references are quoted by Drake and Gorham in his advert to 80,000 lights across the UK in such elegant houses as Chatsworth and Ralston Hall. And Abigail and I plan to do much more to explore the symbiosis of such companies with their elite clients. But anyway, those were not by any means the only agents, and certainly they were very important in the pre-World War I period. But by no means was the task of electrification complete, if it ever was, through them. So the second thing I want to draw upon, and I've been working on this partly through a project mentioned earlier by Daniel called Electrifying Women. Now, in addition to the Women's Engineering Society, the Electrical Association for Women was founded in 1924. As some of you may well have come across this in the writings, of course, of Carol Purcell. What I will direct you to is the 1934 handbook, this wonderful thing called the Electrical Handbook for Women, which was first published in 1934 and had 9 editions, its final one in the 1980s before the EAW was finally closed down. But two extremely influential and energetic women were behind the writing of this book and also behind the Electrical Association for Women. There's a Lady Margaret Moir, who herself was the spouse of a civil engineer. She called herself rather wryly an engineer by marriage. And Caroline Hazlitt, who was an engineer in the First World War making boilers and was the driving force between many engineering enterprises. Now, they matter because it was not the case that women, even after World War I, were widely taking up electrical power into their home. So it was founded by Hazlitt, and it, linking back to the previous discussion, they adopted Lady Nancy Astor as their first president, being also from the USA, like Lady Churchill, but having a lot of power, a lot of influence, being, of course, the first sitting woman MP for the Conservative Party in Britain. Now, the aim initially of the EAW was, at least notionally, was to reduce drudgery for women at home via the use of electricity, and you can see here overtones of Ruth Schwartz Cowan's work, so that women could more easily pursue independent careers, which is something that Schwartz Cowan tends to play down. You might ask, was the EAW needed for that? Well, it was not simply about informing women about electricity. When you read other accounts of the EAW, it's assumed that women simply didn't know about electricity and had to be informed by them. But actually, it's not that. There was a real suspicion of electricity for reasons I argue in the book, Domesticating Electricity. It was expensive, it was difficult to handle, unreliable, not good for cooking, and generally speaking, just too weird. So Caroline Hazlitt herself says in a very big speech at the Empire Exhibition in 1925, in spite of propaganda and the work of clever salesmen, there still exists a wide gap between the suppliers of juice, that being the jargon for electricity, the makers of electrical appliances, and the woman who is the potential customer. And that gap was very big. It's clear to me from looking at this, and I hope it's clear to others who've talked to me about this, that really the work of the EAW was to win the trust of sceptical female householders. And it's mattered in economic terms. If one looks at Leslie Hanna's writing, his book Electricity Before Nationalisation, there's a rather interesting graph which looks at the growth of electrical supply in the UK from 1920 to 1938. And initially there you see the domestic sector is by far the lowest. This is, of course, a logarithmic graph. But by 1935, it's been the fastest growing for quite some time. And the clear indication is this is very much because the EAW had been active in promoting it. And especially in 1930-31, when there was a real slump, it's only in the domestic sector helped by the EAW was there still a significant growth going on. So this matters in economic terms in a big way. Now, I won't say too much about this, but the Ethical Handbook for Women sold really, really well. It was very powerful in getting thousands of women jobs and actually many more actually to accept electricity. But the closure of the AW in 1996 has led to a certain amnesia about its vital role. And you see the myth engineered of the electrification of the UK emerging as if it had been inevitable. But rather interestingly, there's still a branch of the AW active now in Trinidad and Tobago. I've not been able to make much contact with them, but it's evident that there's a project there to be done about how, in the wider world, women's agency is essential for creating the demand for electricity that's often been presumed in more technocratic accounts. So coming towards the end now, we've just got a few slides left. One of the reasons that the Electrical Association for Women ended, it didn't succeed, but only in part, is that it could not displace gas completely as a domestic utility. They tried to make some all electric houses in which every single aspect of life was powered by electricity, including cooking and heating, but it never took off. Only a few were built. Basically, it was too expensive and too inconvenient. UK householders, and I'm interested to know how far this was the case in other countries in Europe, kept gas for both cooking and heating. This is very much evidenced by the work of Anne Clendinning in her wonderful book, Demons of Domesticity, which shows how effectively a parallel organisation, the Women's Gas Federation and the gas demonstrators, made sure that women were very much aware of the benefits of gas being at least as good and often greater than electricity from the point of view of economy, safety and ease. So there's a way in which one might say the domestication of electricity wasn't completed, or at least it wasn't exclusive. It's evident that there are pluralistic energy practices to be factored into all of these discussions. Other energy forms are used, partly, and I use Paul Coleman's term, energy security, in order to avoid being reliant upon one fallible source of energy. It's very prudent for householders, it turns out, to have more than one supply. Another reason then for the process of domestication and electrification not to be completed. And following the excellent work of Ruth Sanawal and leading international comparative studies in this area, it's evident that every culture needs to have its historical energy consumption practices examined without presumption about what is a default. There is no single norm. There is no sense in which either Britain or America or any other early industrializing country leads the way and setting a template for all to follow. So indeed, there's nothing to be taken for granted about whether electricity is completely or exclusively domesticated. They are still processes. So then let me just look forward to the rest of the day. So I think it's a really exciting program for what comes up. It's really fascinating seeing how many great scholars are with us, many good ideas by PhD students, postdocs, and even some well-established professors too, it turns out. I'm looking forward very much in the next session to hearing more about social identities and social choices, really quite contingent matters, very much in flux and shaped by their encounter with electricity. Session three, certainly, it'd be great to hear more about interdisciplinary themes. Certainly, I learned a great deal in writing my book, Domesticating Electricity, from sociologists, anthropologists, and political theorists. So welcome everyone here who's not an historian as a primary interest. Fourthly, I guess modernity is a word I tried really hard to avoid in writing domesticating electricity because I thought it was such an unhelpful, overused, hackneyed term. I don't think it can be problematized enough, but that's only my not very humble view. Perhaps the main use of it now is to look at its contingent political and ideological deployments. I don't know. Anyway, I'm looking forward to time, and I'm not being sarcastic here, when the domestication of electricity is outmoded, it's replaced by much more interesting radical approaches in which international comparative studies are central. Not case studies of dull, clapped-out imperial Britain. Thanks very much.